اینجا وزارت خارجه فرانسه است. در این ساختمان دفتری است که مهمان من در آن با عنوان سفیر فرانسه در امور حقوق بشری کار می‌کند. او در گذشته شهردار، نماینده پارلمان اروپا و فعال حقوق بشری بوده است. با این حال منتقدانی هم دارد که می‌گویند او در نگاهش به نقض حقوق بشر در دنیا بی‌طرف نیست، به خصوص که از مقامات عالی رتبه سازمان‌های یهودی فرانسه هم بوده است. وزارت خارجه فرانسه در مورد حقوق بشر چقدر جدی است؟ Ambassador François Zimmeray, welcome to Bebarak Digar.
Bonjour.
Mr. Zimmeray, what exactly the post of Ambassador for Human Rights or France's Ambassador for Human Rights is about? What do you do?
First, I learned three words in Iranian language, so I would like to tell them. Badohud, be Iran va Iranian.
Thank you very much.
This position of Ambassador for Human Rights exists in French diplomacy since 2000. I'm serving with Minister Bernard Kouchner in order to contribute to this dimension of our diplomacy, which is human rights. You know, a diplomacy for France or any country serves many interests of the country, a wide range of activities, and human rights is definitely for France a large part of our concerns. So I am in charge with a team, we are working as a team here, of this dimension of our diplomacy.
But when Monsieur Kouchner first created this position, was it more substantive? If I remember, Ms. Ramayad, who took over first, she was deputy foreign minister, also junior minister.
Yes, she belonged to the government. I do not belong to the government. I am merely ambassador. Mm-hmm. But you know, human rights is one dimension of diplomacy. It's not all diplomacy. And if you erect this dimension at the governmental level, this architecture leads to antagonism between these dimensions and other dimensions. So on all the art of a policy in any field is to combine, to conciliate several dimensions. So it's easier with the level of ambassador. And definitely there is no less work.
So that was the reason for actually abolishing that position, because it was, as I said, junior minister, but it's not anymore.
Yes, I think it's not a question of person. It's simply a question of architecture. It's easier to conciliate and to combine human rights with other demands, other requirements of our diplomacy. For example, we have to combine our interests in terms of human rights and also economical interests, and to show how it's not opposite, but how to make them going together. And it's not easy. It's more easy to say and to express than to realize.
Indeed, because I'm going to quote you something. You say in our diplomatic position is not that we renounce our ideas and principles, but we should understand how difficult it goes from declaration of human rights to act. That's your words in an interview with French television. Basically, what you're saying is there is a contradiction between the foreign policy and the human rights activity.
No, I don't say there is a contradiction. There is a tension, which is not the same. And it's not contradiction. And I would say that what would be human rights without diplomacy? Human rights are not moral, ethics, ideas going by themselves in the air like that. Human rights, it's not a religion. It's simply rights that exist or do not exist, that are enforced or violated. And those rights have been adopted, for example, Declaration on Convention Against Torture, Convention on Children, Convention on Women's Rights. This is very concrete issues. And before having been adopted, they have been discussed, pushed, amended, and finally adopted and enforced by this multilateral diplomacy. So I would not oppose diplomacy and human rights. What would be the Universal Declaration of Human Rights without diplomats?
Yeah, well, basically, what you're saying, Mr. Ambassador, is that your position is to make sure that these are carried out and implemented. Is that it?
Yes, first to create them, and through, because through rights have to be adopted, universalized. For example, we are fighting for a very noble cause, which is the question of the child soldiers in the world. Universal abolishment of death penalty, equal rights for expression, equal rights of conscience. These are some of examples of the combat, the fight in which we are involved on the multilateral arena, I mean the international arena. Our first mission is to create those rights, because since the rights are not adopted by countries, they do not exist. It's simply invoking principles like a religion, but they are not binding. And after, most difficult is to enforce them. And we are in a world where countries are independent, sovereign, and it's not easy to get to oblige on people to fulfill his commitments.
But Mr. Ambassador, I mean, you say there's no contradiction, but your foreign minister doesn't seem to agree with you, because Mr. Kushner says that it is a mistake mistake to create a junior minister for human rights, he says, because there's a permanent contradiction between human rights and nations' foreign policy, even in France.
One has to interpret what Bernard Kouchner wanted to say very clearly. Bernard Kouchner is fully committed to human rights. All his life is devoted to human rights, so one cannot
suspect
him. That
makes it very strange.
But he said, he simply wanted to say that there is a tension between this demand, this aspiration for human rights, and other requirements of diplomacy. And that's why one has not to make an antagonism which would lead to clashes between those who are in charge of human rights in Foreign Office and those who are in charge of other aspects of foreign policy. And this is what he wanted to say.
Now, but despite that, I mean, many people are critical of the way the approach to the human rights generally.
In France?
France. For example, even the ex-junior minister is critical of both Mr. Sarkozy and Mr. Kushner, saying this for failure to condemn, for example, the human rights violations in Tibet, in Libya, in Uzbekistan, in Turkmenistan, and all that. So there's no consistency in the foreign policy of the French government.
I would not say that. First, having a policy of human rights doesn't mean only condemning, blaming, shaming. We are not in the field of declarations, the field of postures, which would be much easier for us, in fact. But who are we to do that? We would like not to do human rights for ourselves, for our own image, but simply to be useful. And to be useful, to lead to concrete changes, one has to find the words to lead to significant changes and to address leaders. So one has to find the words, and it's not always by public and vocal condemnation that we can get the better results. Mm-hmm. But sometimes symbols are important, and we are on the side of those who invoke human rights. Our diplomatic network is fully committed to help, to receive, to protect human rights defenders all over the world. All the diplomats of the world can tell you how involved is our teams in Geneva, in New York, in order to push those texts.
Can it be all done through the United Nations Commission for Human Rights,
definitely,
rather than having an ambassador in the foreign ministry?
Definitely, this is a part of our activity. Mm-hmm. This is a pot where the Human Rights Council is a pot where human rights are elaborated, but it's not the only arena for that. We have also the Conseil de l'Europe in Strasbourg. We have also Human Dimension in OSCE in Vienna. We have also New York, United Nations Plenary. And we have, as France, the most important diplomatic and cultural network in the world. So we have embassies, cultural centers, high schools everywhere, and our embassies have to be, according to the orientation of Bernard Kouchner, houses of human rights. House of human rights means greeting the human rights defenders, protect them, recognize them, help them, and do that everywhere in the world, and that's what we are doing.
Right, let's go to Iran. Your foreign minister, Mr. Kushner, has said that they're rescuing Sakineh Ashtiani, the woman who's under the threat of death by stoning in Iran, is for him a personal matter as a national issue for France.
Yes, it was also a declaration of our president, President Sarkozy said, yes,
yeah. Why,
definitely.
Why national issue in France?
Because she is a symbol of all the women in the world who are deprived of their own rights. She is a symbol of the resistance against male oppression. She is a symbol of the resistance against unfair trial. So she is a very symbol, the most important symbol one could find, of what is a victim of attempts of violations of all the fundamental rights recognized by the majority of nations.
It is
and simply we think that she's innocent.
Mm-hmm. It is reported that the last year, I mean reported unofficially, obviously, the Saudi Arabia never gives any figure about what's happening in their country in terms of in cases of human rights violations. But apparently, according to some reports, there's been cases of stoning in Saudi Arabia last year. There was one in Iran. How come this issue is not a national issue in Saudi Arabia for France?
You're right. You're right that human rights should not be divided. And they are not divided. This cause is universal. We really believe in this word, universal, which is at the very heart of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is the only text which reivindicates this universal dimension. And you're perfectly right. One should be coherent on what we ask to one country, what we ask also to other countries.
Why aren't you? Why aren't you, Ambassador?
We are doing as well for, of course.
I haven't seen any declaration by the by your department about the Saudi Arabia.
I can tell you that we condemn everywhere, including Saudi Arabia, when they practice stoning, and we really expect this country to accomplish some improvements in terms of human rights, as we are demanding for all countries in the world. We are not specially obsessed by Iran. We used to have excellent relations with your country. We consider Iran as a great civilization who has a lot to bring to the world. The world deserves a better voice for Iran now. We are not concentrated on Iran, but Iran concentrates a lot of attempts of human rights. And what you are describing is really something that I really suffer in my function of human rights. Defender, human rights ambassador.
So you do, Ambassador, yes, you do not, realize that there is these criticism towards your sake.
I realize that there is a misperception on not always homogeneous treatment, not especially in diplomacy.
I think so. What the harsher criticism media, by people is double standard, basically. That's what they say.
I understand that. Mm-hmm. You know, I travel all over the world. I have accomplished in 2 years and a half more than 60 missions. And I can tell you that I have seen horrible things in countries where the things are never reported. Attempts of human rights that are not reported, and even if they are reported, medias and politics do not talk about them.
Yeah.
You're perfectly right. Yeah. And my function is to make our policy more open to what happened in those dead angles, and to put the light in the dark.
You know, the other criticism by concentrating, by France concentrating especially on these cases of Mrs. Ashtiani, is that you're ignoring the other aspect, the wider scale of human rights violation in Iran.
Yes, you're right. In any policy, this could be an inconvenient. Mm-hmm. For example, in Burma, it's common to defend, for example, and she deserves to be defended, Mrs. Aung San Suu Kyi, but who recalls that behind her, 2,150 persons are jailed because of their political opinion. So you're perfectly right. By concentrating on one person, one could hide the huge reality of the number of persons. But in the contrary, if one do not make some symbols to express, to personalize, it remains very abstract. If I say to public opinion, there are a lot of persons jailed in Iran for public opinion, on they are facing a very cruel punishment, an unfair punishment. This remains very abstract.
There are people who are suggesting that instead of these kind of individual activities and condemnations or whatever campaign for human rights, if the cases of human rights violation in Iran brought to the Security Council of the United Nations, and the United Nations, there is a resolution against Iran for the violation of human rights, that resolution will be implementable internationally, more forceful than any other individual campaigns. What do you say to that, for those people who suggest that?
I think you're perfectly right. And so this resolution would not be against Iran, but against Iran's today's policy, which is different. We are not, and particularly as friends, we are not against Iran. We are on the side of Iranian people. We would like to see Iran alongside us in many combats we have to fight in the world. And we are sad that one cannot count on Iran now because of this really shocking and shocking policy.
There are also other people who criticize that and say that the main aim of the Western countries against Iran, even by bringing forward the human rights, but behind that, they're worried about the nuclear issue. And if there is a nuclear settlement, some sort of agreement between Iran and the West over the nuclear program, the West will forget about the human rights altogether.
No, definitely not. Definitely not. There is a nuclear issue, but there is as well a human rights issue, which is
so the human rights issues will be as important even if the nuclear issue is resolved?
Of course.
Okay. What about the France? Do you think that the Burqa law is accords with the human rights?
Yes, of course. And particularly if it's in fully accordance with women's dignity. We are not against religions. Religions are, and all religious practices are fully tolerated here in France and protected by law and by court. I have to say that freedom of conscience, freedom of expression, freedom of religion are key in our country.
But not many people agree with you, Ambassador. I mean, they are even saying that it could be even unconstitutional. They may go to the Court of Appeal or whatever.
And, yes, for the moment, the Constitutional Council have not yet decided something different to that.
Do you think France is determined to carry out this?
What are we talking about? Simply the right for women to decide how and not to be a slave of their husband. And also, it is a part of human dignity to be face to face.
But Ambassador, I mean, the figures are there, but basically can be relied upon, is about 2,300 people who actually wear this niqab in France.
Even less.
And even then, they are very inconsistent. Mm-hmm. Do you think it's not provocation? By the tiny minority are wearing hijab. What's wrong with that? This is happening in other European countries as well. Nobody's bothered.
Provocation is simply the fact that to be completely veiled and wearing the burqa, this is a provocation in French society. And definitely we consider that this is not in accordance with the idea we have of women's dignity. In many cases, women who wear burqa do that because their husband obliged them to do that. First. Second, in terms of security and in terms of the idea we have of a dignity of relations between persons, one has to show one's face. Having said that, if a woman wants to wear a chador of any kind of veil, she's completely free to do that in France. This is allowed. What is not allowed is to cover completely the face. And also what is not allowed is to show distinctive religious signs in schools and public services. Distinctive religious signs, it's not only focuses on Islam, it's also crosses or kippahs for Jews, crosses for Christians. This is our conception of laïcité, which means that as religion and state have to be separated, and religion belongs to private circle. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we haven't got much time. Let's move on to the Middle East. Ambassador, there are people who say they are critical of the fact that saying that being ambassador on human rights and at the same time being the high-ranking official of the Representative Council of French Jewish Institutes, CRIF, is just incompatible. It's a contradiction.
Why? First, I'm not. I resigned from this position when I took my position of ambassador for human rights. First, second, I don't see how being a Jew would be incompatible with being involved in human rights. On the contrary, I think the very values of Judaism are in accordance with human rights.
Absolutely. I mean, there are so, very values of other
so
religions as well.
But simply, I'm not.
But that's
not
the
any,
point.
I'm not. To answer your question, I'm not anymore a member.
You're not active, but your ideas are there.
It's not because, ideas. It's yeah. belonging to.
It's not just belonging. It's because what the criticism is well, that the
I will, if you allow me, I will yeah. reformulate your question.
Okay.
Is it compatible to defend human rights and to defend Israel? This is your question.
Yeah.
Is of it? Course, it is defending, and you know, I want to tell you what I think. This conflict is not a conflict between Israelis and Palestinians. It's not a conflict between two parties. It's a conflict between three parties: Israelis, Palestinians, and the rest of the world, including Iran today's policy, Iran leaders, who fuel this conflict. And for me, I have been twice in Gaza this year. I know the reality there. I know what people are suffering. I know also the difficulty of Israelis enduring the rockets and bombings financed by Iran government. I know this is a part of a global figure, and I can tell you that human rights should not be divided.
But
they are not human rights for one
but
party.
But do you see, Ambassador, the other side as well? I mean, there are a huge number of Palestinians
yes.
being killed by Israelis.
Exact.
I mean,
you're right.
Incomparable in terms of figures.
That's why human rights should not be divided. There are not human rights for Israelis and human rights for...
The repercussion of this is that those who are criticizing you saying that the result would be that you propose that the aim by the EU to the Palestinians should be conditional for the Palestinian to remove all bad references, negative references to Israel from the textbook.
In both camps, of course. You know, France and Germany fought 26 times in 5 centuries. And after the World War II, before setting up the foundation of Europe, De Gaulle and Adenauer, French and German leaders, went around the table and they set up a joint committee in order to remove anti-French sentences from German textbooks and anti-German sentences from French textbooks. And at this time, we started to look at the Germans with other eyes and to name them with other names. This was the very beginning of building a very strong partnership. But to come back on this issue in one word, for me, it doesn't mean anything to be, and according to human rights, to be pro-Israeli or pro-Palestinian. If you are pro-Israeli, you have to be pro-Palestinian, because what is the future of Israel if it's in perpetual war with its neighbors? Israel needs to have a Palestinian state living peacefully with him. And what means being pro-Palestinian if you are against Israel? You want also the war for the Palestinians? If you are pro-Palestinian, you have to be, for the same reasons, pro-Israeli. And so our policy is to be pro-Palestinian and pro-Israeli, pro-Palestinian because pro-Israeli, and pro-Israeli because pro-Palestinian, because the future of those two peoples is linked. And the Iranian government is the only government in the world who continues to call for a new Holocaust for a state who belongs to the UN. And this is not bringing a good image.
You're right, Ambassador, that President Ahmadinejad has on many occasions provoked all these kind of negative talks about the Holocaust and Israelis and all that. But at the same time, they also propose that there should be some sort of a referendum by the whole people in Palestine, as they call it, and decide about the future of Palestine. They also propose that as well. I was not just saying that, going around anyway. And saying, yeah, we're not discussing that. But let me finish the our interview with this question that many people believe that if the Israeli and Palestinian situation is settled, if the occupation is ended, many other issues in the Middle East, can, including the human rights, can easily be resolved. Do you agree with that?
No, I don't agree with that. I don't agree. Of course, I think that this is a conflict I would love to see solved soon. And a large part of our concerns would be concentrated on other causes. But I do not agree with this idea that this is the very cause of all the conflicts, all the terrorism in the world. For example, 2 weeks ago, French people in Niger, in Western Africa, have been taken in hostages by Al-Qaeda. This has nothing to do with Israeli-Palestinian conflict. A few years ago, in Algeria, 200 people died because of Islamism, fanatism of the GIA bombings. This has nothing to do with Israeli-Palestinian people. So, yes, I would like this conflict to be solved soon. But no, this is not the key of all the problems of the world.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Frans Fazimre, for being the guest of Biabarat Diga.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.